Welcome to Raw Down.
True.
Oh, I'm live? Let's go.
One all right, keep on.
All right, start with that one of a kind. All right, everybody. Ty is eating 17 pounds of beef right now, so I get to introduce the show.
17 pounds.
And speaking of 17 pounds of beef, this show that was moderately acceptable, I guess. Who was talking in the background? Who was coming to us from a portal? What happened? Anyway. Triple H has a COD montage made for him to some off-brand Linkin Park song to start the show. I guess that was cool. I don't know. They're trying really hard to make this guy that has lost 17 times in a row seem great. Also, most important thing about this show, Jim Ross is back. Thank God.
Yeah.
Nowhere to be seen. Jerry Lawler put in maybe his worst effort on commentary that he's done ever, which is a lot, but it evens out. It's fine. And the beef man himself, Triple H, is coming out to tell us a bunch of bullshit. Emerald, what does he got to say?
Well, he comes up lit up like a fucking disco king because they are just strobing those lights on him. He's flashing so many different colors. Now, he's here because he feels it is his right as the King of Kings.
Hold up. Nico, you're breathing right into the mic.
I'm sorry. I tried to put it closer so you could hear me.
You're good.
You need to lean away to the mic so you can breathe.
All right. Chocolate Rain Nico may or may not be in the episode.
Amen, brother.
Yeah, Emerald, Disco Ball Triple H, whatever the fuck you were talking about, take it again.
Yeah, so Disco Ball Triple H, he's here. He is the King of Kings. He feels it is his right as the one who can just ignore all the rules and get another shot at the WWE championship title. And so he's calling out John Cena. John Cena comes out with the belt. He's like, come on, man, you gotta stop doing this. We get it. You've gotten like 10 titles in the past. He says something about a sports team who's unmemorable. I forget.
The New York Yankees, unmemorable. I agree.
Hell.
Fuck the Yankees.
Hell yeah. Trips to the Yankees.
Emerald.
Confirmed.
Ah, Emerald. Emerald's here. Emerald, yeah. I know you got Aaron Judge in your closet. Not the jersey.
No,
he's got Aaron Judge in his closet.
Stinky. Get him out of here. He's stinky.
You can't prove that.
Emerald, you can't kidnap the Yankees.
You can. That. I did it.
Emerald invented Lou Gehrig's disease.
Wow. Don't fucking tell them that.
You're a pile, man.
John Cena's here. He's like, listen, I get it. Yeah, I got mad respect for you because you did all this cool stuff in the past, but I did pin you. I did make you tap out. You need to stop. I can either A, keep telling you to knock it off and you're just going to keep coming back. B, right here, right now, we're going to do a title match shot so you can try to win this belt again. And it goes for option B, and everyone's all riled up. They're going to do a right here, right now, get a ref. They're gonna fight it out for the title. But who comes out? It's Vince McMahon. He's
Woo!
Like,
no.
Yeah!
Take
the
heart of Vince McMahon.
and so he starts to scold Triple H, like, you can't keep doing this. I can't keep rolling over for you to try to get this fucking title. Triple H looks like the absolute saddest toddler right now, because
yes.
Vince is like, should I just, like, keep trying to do this? Should I just cancel all the rules just for you? He's like,
yeah.
The saddest toddler, man.
Well, listen, I got some backstory for you, Emerald. You know who's in the crowd today?
Ooh.
It's Lemmy from Motorhead. That's Triple H's idol. So now he's getting dogged out by his dad-in-law and in front of his idol. So now Triple H is big sad.
Ooh.
That's his theme song. Lemmy from Motorhead. So if you hear the, I'm out of the game, and how you play it.
Oh,
that's
okay.
It's him. Yeah.
And so...
Did you ever see... Let me try to play that live, like, years after he recorded it, and he just
wasn't
he
it that mania.
Anything. I think it was at Mania, yeah. And he just doesn't remember any of the lyrics.
Sick.
Yeah, the audience is listening to it right now. There you go.
So Vince is like, all right, you know what? I will give you another shot at the title. Just not right now. In the future, I promise. But for now, you, Triple H, have the night off. And tells him to get out of the ring. And so Triple H gets all sad and walks away. And then he points at John Cena, and now you...
Oh, man.
You're not going anywhere, because you and Shawn Michaels are tag-teaming it up against the Spirit Squad.
That don't sound bad.
Woo! Because Shawn Michaels prevented Kenny from getting the title last week. Thank you, Shawn Michaels. Heartbreak Kid. Love to see him. And yeah, that was about it that happened with that.
This did not need to be as long as it was.
Yeah, no, John Cena tried to do a kiss my ass, but Vince cut his mic. I will say, though, during this whole segment, a lot of good signs. I got a Caesar Jr. sign, whatever the fuck that means.
I think Caesar Jr. is a reference to earlier in the year at the Rumble or whatever they did. Like advertisements where the McMahons were dressed as Roman emperors and Vince was Vince Caesar. And then Shane stabbed Vince and hit the Shane dance.
At pretty two Shanekus.
Yes, that was it.
I'll say there was a moment in this promo with like when Triple H called him a poser where it got a little lively, but this is kind of too long, typical Cena age.
Do we have a runtime for this?
That's got to be like 21 minutes.
Yeah, sounds about right. I got a JoJo sign. Now, was it JoJo's Bizarre Adventure? Who could say? I got a Bow Down to the King Triple H sign. Triple H can't see Cena sign. The game sign 15. With a really impressive artwork of the game. As Triple H was calling out John Cena, he said that he wants Cena.
I was about to say
yes.
And stop.
Yeah, I got a little chub on that. I was like, damn, all right.
And then, and it's better, the announcers are on our side, because Jerry then yells, oh, he wants it all.
That's right, baby. Mm-hmm.
Thank fucking God Jim's here.
Yeah, I was just like Glenn Jacobs in the movie See No Evil, when I saw that girl in the cage. That's what I wanted. I wanted Cena and Triple H to kiss. But we didn't get it.
Yeah, check out our review that's been out for 9 months by the time.
May 19th, guys.
May 19th.
Remember May 19th? It's May... What? I don't know. What is it?
It's probably
May
8th.
It's May 8th in Anaheim, California.
Like yes, Babe Ruth, I'm going to call my shot. It's June 25th. There we go.
And
all right. If Ty's right, you have to subscribe.
last sign before we move on to the next segment.
Oh,
you can't see me, but you can marry me by some chick in the crowd.
I wonder
that's
how
where
doing.
You're wrong, bitch. There's one more sign. It says we miss you, Eddie. Ty is in shame.
I'm angry. I'm sick of it.
I wish.
Good thing Travis
has
gone.
Ever missed Eddie.
Good thing Ray's getting jobbed out. On his own show, they're done with Eddie. You know what? They respect Eddie, but they hate all the Eddie lovers.
That's right.
So it's good. It's fine.
It's something.
You know who doesn't love Eddie?
Who doesn't love Eddie?
You.
RVD.
What? One of a kind.
I think the 15-minute mark. 18
yeah.
Minutes?
Yeah, I don't know if Emerald said the ending of that promo, but he goes, listen, there's going to be a title match tonight, but it's not you, Cena. It's going to be for the Intercontinental Championship, Fatal 4-Way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then, One of a Kind comes out. Dude, that teal outfit he's got on, I loved it. Someone airbrushed
that
just
like
right.
Spooky skull face on it.
Yeah, that was
good.
Yeah. He's got his early 90s Grant Hill Pistons jersey
yes!
on. Going crazy.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I like the little stare down they had. I thought it was good.
I wonder if he'll cash in. Hmm? Huh?
I doubt it.
Does Emerald know about what Money in the Bank does?
You get to a free shot anytime, anywhere, the title.
Yeah, that's why they were staring each other down, because Robbie and Matt could come for John Cena at any point.
I guess it's not anywhere.
I don't think RVD's going to remember to cash that in. That's my guess.
Why would he not remember it?
Hey, you got a problem?
He does a lot of flips. His brain's rattling.
Because he'd be smoking that 420 Kush, baby.
From Battle Creek, Michigan, the Kush
Monster. I'm going to break into future knowledge here. Shockingly enough, Rob Van Dam is one of the least CTE'd out of his mind wrestlers you'll find, and he's actually still in good shape.
Yeah,
I don't know how.
Well, yeah, look at the way he moves in the ring. He has to stay in shape.
He stays flexy. He watches that guy's YouTube shorts.
Oh no,
he's a better condition than Bobby Allen. Okay,
you know what he does do?
Of doing a barrel roll.
He respected Joey Styles.
He did.
RVD said, everything Joey Styles says is right. I know you guys like to chant my name, but we need to chant three different letters instead. E-C-Dub. And then the crowd went crazy. The crowd clearly hates the Fed. It is E-C-Dub's time.
It's very funny that they just don't like their own. You paid money to come here, guys.
Yeah, it's wild, but I loved it.
Oh no! So, real quick.
Yep.
What is up with ECW? Why do you keep showing off? Like, that's never coming back.
It's weird.
It's like what TNA does. You want to get some money in, so you just yell ECW and the fucking mocks cheer.
Oh yeah. You know what? You're right. You're right. Fair enough. Yeah,
it's
Dave.
It's TNA 2010.
Tell me about Charlie Haas.
Man, so Charlie Haas, Shelton Benjamin's ex-teammate, who they brought out from the fucking crypt to try to do a whole bit, just doesn't really get an entrance or do anything or have any development, and now is just kind of part of the background roster. I don't understand the fucking point of Charlie Haas. But
yeah.
Hey, you know, who can say? Chris Masters, also just kind of out there, wandering around like a Cro-Magnon that he is.
You got a job opportunity this week.
No, Chris,
yeah.
I thought Chris got a little entrance. He's going to get his full entrance.
No, neither of them got an entrance.
Wow.
Yeah, well, Chris Masters' song was still playing.
Oh, okay.
And then Lillian Garcia announces the type of match, and then I guess the star of the match came out.
Yeah, and then Shelmy Bembe comes down to the ring, and everyone goes, oh, he might do it. He might win. And then RVV says,
No way. It was weird, too, because they, like, announced that it was a Fatal 4-Way, and, like...
Yeah, with only three people in the ring.
Yeah, like, what the fuck?
And then Shelmy Bembe comes out.
Yep, ain't no stopping him, nah.
Ain't no stopping me, ah. So, the match starts, he immediately cannot be stopped, and RVD just rolls out of the ring. So, Chris Masters and Benjamin just do an array of tag team maneuvers against Charlie Haas. You know, just... double suplexing him, both kicking him in the head, etc. And then Shelton Benjamin goes to make the pin, and then Masters ends the teamwork, throwing Benjamin out of the ring. Mm-hmm. He has decided that friendship is over.
Oh, again?
Friendship's so bad.
Yeah, there's a couple more, you know, bog standard kick a guy on the grounds, and then we go to commercial. Returning with Masters pinning RVD, and then Shelton coming up to raking his eyes to break that pin. Followed by then an array of typical four-way spots, just everyone Irish whipping each other into drop kicks and, you know, things like that, which gets broken up by RVD hitting a rolling thunder onto Masters from out of nowhere. Shelton then grabbing RVD and just starts choking him out on the ground and then hitting him with a back suplex. The match goes from being very sleepy to very action-packed and then back to sleepy. Very repeatedly over the course.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird flow, too, because, like, it starts off of a commercial, it goes for about 2 minutes, then there's another commercial, then they're back. It's probably a long match, but there's, like, three commercials there, and it's really weird.
Yeah, and, like, so, you know, again, they go into an array of just whatever moves, and then Haas throws Shelton Benjamin out, suplexes RVD, kicks his spine off his fucking back with the loudest kicks you've ever heard. And then Masters comes in and breaks that up. Those two get thrown out of the ring. And then RVB and Shelton Benjamin then go into, I think, one of the best spots of the night, where they are just continually reversing each other's moves.
That was rad.
So, like, yeah, like, Benjamin goes to hit him with some sort of suplex, which RVB reverses into a sunset flip, and then tries to roll him up into a cradle, which Benjamin then breaks out, and then hits him in the back with an inverted backbreaker. Mm-hmm. That's great. And then those two get shuffled out of the ring, I guess, to take a nap after they do the most work anyone in this match has done in a long time. And then Masters locks Haas into the Master Lock. RVD comes flying in off the top rope from off camera into some sort of nosedive hookery do to pin Masters and then retain. It was just an all-in-all great match. Surprisingly. Yeah.
The nosedive hookery do is a sunset flip for those at home, but he jumped across the whole ring over two men.
That was cool.
My fiance was crocheting and in the same room as me watching this, and she popped for this. She lost her mind. It got her out of her double stitch or whatever. I don't know.
Excellent. Yeah, it was probably the best match with both RVD and Shelton Benjamin by far. I thought Haas and Masters did a pretty good job.
Did pretty good, but they gave him the jobber entrance, so you knew that they weren't going to do anything anyway, and they were just kind of here to supplement the action between RVG and Benjamin.
And they did a good job in that, I thought.
Definitely.
Like, not too flashy, but consistent. Like, nobody was fucking up or making this just bad. And I thought the ending spot was super cool. And it's a good match.
See, here's the thing that I have.
Uh-oh.
I didn't think it was a good match, but here's what I'm going to say about it. Here's what I'm going to say about it. A bad match is interesting. A good match is memorable. This match was so mid, I don't remember anything about it, and that makes it even worse than bad. So here's the thing about it.
Damn.
Chris Masters looked the worst he's ever been, and there you go, Martin. There you go. Chris Masters looks even worse than I've ever imagined. I don't know, maybe Carlito was carrying him the whole time, but holy shit, he looked really bad. Shelton Benjamin and RVD have zero chemistry, which is unfortunate. Mm-hmm. Because they should.
Well, that's true.
They should match at Backlash. It was just too long, and I was wondering maybe they just, like, you know, had to add more to it.
Had to pad because of whatever happened before.
Even when they don't have a lot of time, I mean, 10 minutes is a good amount for a Fatal 4-Way, but just nothing. And they killed Charlie Haas. Anything that they had about that man, I got excited about. You know, he had that little feud with Shelton. They did nothing with it. He didn't even get an entrance. Nobody knows who it is. Martin still asked me on the daily, who the hell is Charlie Haas?
This is true, folks. Peek behind the scenes.
And RVD winning with a sunset flip was creative. But, like, that was the only highlight of the match, was just, you know, like, they were able to counter Master Lock into a sunset flip, and that got the win and made Masters look bad. I don't think looked good in this, but I see why it was, like, a tolerable TV match. It was fine. It was mid, but it was just boring. The crowd wasn't into it either.
Yeah, I gotta know what I have to hear what Martin.
I think that's a bit meaner version of what I think. I largely agree, but it's a tad harsh from me. But again, get the soundboard up.
Oh.
I think that's a bit mean to Chris Masters. He's been worse before.
I agree.
Ooh.
So there's some light defense. I've seen him do worse.
Well, to be fair, you also didn't like the Backlash match, and I liked it. So we just got different tastes, I guess.
Also, I don't remember any goddamn thing he does in this whole match.
Yeah, I know.
At all,
that's what I'm saying.
I have zero notes about Chris Masters other than he's here and he got pinned. But that's fine. Most of Chris Masters' matches, I point out something he fucks up. I don't think he blew anything. So
I was sitting there shocked and surprised and proud of Dave for able to go through the match, and I'm sitting there going, how the hell, because I can't.
So, like, before we move on, Kai, I mean, why, now look, it's no secret that we know that RVD fucking hard carries every match that consists of the Intercontinental four-way garbage every time. Yeah. Especially that Shelton Benjamin match where it was RVD carrying for 20 minutes because Benjamin got gassed. But why did you think that this was the worst Masters has ever looked ever in his life? I need to know. It's hilarious to me.
All right, so there was one spot that I could tell you right now. So Charlie Haas was in the back getting his shit kicked in by Shelton Benjamin. And instead of, you know, Chris Masters going, I'm going to beat up RVD, he kind of like tossed him out of the ring. And then he's like, I'm going to join in with you, Shelton. I'm going to beat up Charlie Haas. And he starts trying to kick and he's just hitting his fucking shin. He can't get in there and kick. So he's just lightly hitting his shin over and over again. And I'm like, Chris, come on, man. I get he's young and maybe he doesn't do too many multi-man matches, but Jesus Christ, do something else.
He got Charlie Haas in the master lock later.
That was it. Then he got rolled up.
That was a finish.
Yeah. So like,
it was a good finish though.
But now sometimes it makes me it makes me believe that Martin was right the whole time and that he's got a one match or one move guy.
Yeah.
And I'm like, damn, that sucks.
No, he's three moves.
But let me tell you about some of these signs I saw in the crowd during this match. I got Horst, Kurt, Grace, see ya on you. I saw I pooped Vince McMahon.
I pooped Vince. Then I saw that in the beginning.
I saw this very weird sign in the back that said Raw and had this weird black and white photo of someone's face. It was super creepy. Then I saw a Mickey Mouse You Can't See Me sign. And then a big Rob Van Dam hype up sign. That's about it, though.
I just want to real quick blow up Ty and I's spot.
Oh my.
Just bring this out into the open now. Because Dave said Rob Van Dam hard carries every match he's been in. Listeners, you've kind of heard sort of an undercurrent of Ty and I muttering about this. It's been mostly off.
I was going to say something.
Rob Van Dam is he's almost on pack watch.
Yeah, no, it's bad, dude. Every match. So, like, let's just say for 2006, it's not it, pal. And you could say, he's had at
someone
least
explain
one
to the audience what him being on pack watch means.
I'm not sure he's trying or good. His reputation may be a bit blown up. I am applying this is 2006 WWE to this.
Going off what we've watched, at least so far, yeah. Like, I don't know. I'm not going off past or future accomplishments. What we've seen this year has been extremely mid. And I guess that's what he's going for because he hates sports entertainment. So
I've seen him have better matches in 2024 than I have here.
Yeah. They've had him fight Schnitzky. Look,
I'm not going to say that that he isn't being mid, but in all these matches, I feel like he is somehow the standout star when we
that's
know he
the
can
problem.
Be way better.
Well, it's also he's being presented to be that. Look, is he...
Sure, I guess, but you watch what those other buffoons did in the ring every match? That's
okay,
nothing.
Fine. Yes, is he better than these other three guys? Yeah, that's true, but...
Yes.
You know? So... All right, get the soundboard out again.
Oh, my.
So is Triple H.
Bruh.
Yeah. No, I mean, I agree. You know I like Triple H.
Yeah, like, we had one or two, maybe three good Triple H matches this year. You know, you just, it's tough, man.
He's trying sometimes.
I might be a little too harsh on it, but I feel like RVD has been mid this year. The Money in the Bank was carried by a lot of other people.
One of a kind.
As the resident newbie here, I don't know what the fuck any of y'all are talking about. That man's doing flips.
All right. Show him Osprey.
Right,
yeah, you don't
like
have
we've
to.
Been on this segment for too long.
What do you mean?
Next week, Ty and I are reviewing Ospreay versus Danielson, and that's it.
Sure.
Anyway, yeah, that'll So, and then that whole review will get cut out of the podcast. Just like this next segment got cut out of Raw because apparently live and not on Peacock, there were two little segments of like backstage footage and interviews with producers and cast. Of See No Evil, check out our review from 7 years ago by the time you listen to this, where the producers and actors are like, Man, Kane is crazy. This guy's not okay. I don't like him. I think he might actually be evil. And then Kane just chokes one of the actors, and that's basically what? The end of it.
So, I didn't get to see this suppose... sent to me.
So I didn't watch this. I saw a guy on a blog talking about this. So, hey, listener, maybe it'll be up. Maybe it won't. Who knows? Maybe this guy lied to me, but it sounds like a thing they do. Speaking of lies, teachers lie all the time. You know who's a teacher? Matt Stryker. Nico, yes, tell us about him.
Ah, yes, Matt Stryker, the enigmatic teacher. So, you know, before we begin, Burger King got a new cheesy Angus beef burger. I know everybody
you
wanna
get
is
one?
Ready for...
No. Oh.
Not now. Maybe at some point later. But, okay. So it plays a segment, from 3 weeks ago, which was the last time Stryker and Carlito, I believe, even shared a fucking ring. So, you know, it was fine, whatever. We talked about it probably 8 months ago with the upload schedule. Anyways, we get in the match, and do you guys want to be cool?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Not really.
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay, well, outside Benny, a.k.a. Matt Stryker here, we got Carlito coming out, and he is coming out, and he's cool, and the fans think he's cool, and he comes out.
I don't think Nico thinks he's cool. I don't believe this for a second. I don't believe him for a second, folks.
And then... in one of the crispiest Argyle sweater vests I have seen, Matt Stryker comes out. Matt Stryker's coming out, and he looks like a man with a plan.
Oh, no.
And they get it ring. And honestly, I think I've said this before. Carlito matches, to me, are some of the middest matches around, as I actually don't remember Carlito even wrestling half the time. I actually thought he was doing pretty decent, and there was Stryker. I thought Stryker was doing they didn't do anything special. There were like a couple turnbuckle elbows, a couple slams, nothing. And then Carlito gets him into the corner, and Carlito is ready to be super cool. He's gearing up. He's about to be the coolest son of a bitch. When everybody's favorite, except mine, Eugene, comes into the scene, and he beats up Matt Stryker for the disqualification. Why?
Well, do you not remember Backlash?
No, I remember Backlash.
Well, that's why.
That was 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
On a segment that was 3 weeks ago, I thought I was watching AEW for a minute.
Well, they weren't allowed to be on the show because Spirit Squad was booking it.
Yeah, but... fuck Spirit Squad.
They didn't want Eugene out there. They were making fun of him in the back, remember?
Yeah, I remember that, but it was like... I don't know, it's just like... you might as well have shown both, because all they did was show fucking Carlito from 3 weeks ago with Stryker, because, I mean, that was the match. It might as well have brought up Eugene, but I don't remember them ever bringing him up. I don't know, it wasn't really a match. It was a setup for an angle. So... it exists. It filled time. People like Carlito, I think.
Yeah, Carlito is cool. You saw the sign.
Yeah, Carlito was cool. I think he's kind of doing better as a babyface. So, I don't know. This was really, really okay. And, you know, he's not beating up Max dudes in the back, so... it's something new.
Yeah, so... I agree. Nico's right. WWE fans shouldn't be expecting ever anything for... more than 2 hours, much less 8 days. He's right.
Yeah.
Jim Ross shoots on Matt Stryker and the concept of teachers, saying he can't remember any of them for some reason.
Yeah, that was a disrespectful take, but he did say so.
Nah, he's right. Also, Carlito invents the springboard Judas effect.
Yeah, he kind of did, didn't he?
So, can someone explain to me why Eugene interrupting the fight was a disqualification?
Because, yeah, he was beating up the other guy. He's not in the match.
Okay, yeah. Why couldn't they just, you know, pause and get him out of there?
No.
Because
they do damage, which means he's loosened up, which means he's now at a disadvantage. It's not
Like, if you were fighting me and then Triple H gave you a pedigree, you'd be in much worse shape for me continuing to fight you. That's not fair.
I
wouldn't allow Triple H to get the drop on me.
Oh, he would. Even now with his talk condition.
Yeah, you don't have a...
It's all about the game.
And how you play it.
That's not true. You'd hear him going, from 20 feet away.
Yeah, you could hear
I'd probably smell his wet ass.
All right.
Coming from a mile away.
Speaking of wet ass, Nico brought up Burger King, but I forgot. That was the WWE Slam of the Week. Slam of the Week is Carlito spitting da apple at Matt Stryker. Yet again, not a slam. Not because a slam.
He wants the cheesy bacon Angus beef burger.
Yeah, that's how you get it, folks.
That's the slam of the week.
Burger King, it's on the secret menu. Yep. Go to Burger King, spit an apple in their face. They'll give you a whatever the fuck burger they're advertising.
It's true. Burger King hates apples. They're like doctors.
What do you mean by that?
An apple a day keeps the doctors away. So you go to Burger King, it keeps them from selling you a Whopper.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's because doctors are just English vampires.
Oh, my.
You know, also, since, you know, he's going to mention wet ass, everybody looked extra sweaty today, so I'm sure that
Well, they're in California.
In the slightest.
Oh, hey, cold open. We're in California today, guys. We're in Anaheim.
Yes.
It's May 8th.
It is. Welcome.
Welcome to the start of the show. All right. Emerald, get in the opening promo.
You fucking...
That's you, pal.
Hurry up.
That's you on the rundown.
Hey, listen. Listen, we got Edge here. Edge is here for his hardcore match. Lead is looking insanely respectful.
Hardcore hell.
Edge Sheeran.
Yeah, it was very hardcore. I was going crazy. I was like, damn. Edge gets on the mic. He starts dropping some knowledge about how Anaheim... It's full of wieners and idiots.
It's true. It's true. We live in the Golden State.
The Golden State? That's in Oakland, pal.
Who cares about Oakland?
Mick Foley is like a lot of idiot California people here. You know, he beat him in the greatest hardcore match of all time. You know, now we got the sequel, and there's not going to be a happy ending. Get your ass out here, Foley, so I can go rated R on your ass.
I knew we were going to see.
And then Mick Foley comes out. He's got the bat.
Bat.
And he gets on the mic and he goes, "You know what, Edge? You're right. We did have the greatest hardcore match in history. I don't agree." Mm-hmm. So, you know, the winner of tonight's match could be that they're the greatest hardcore champion alive. Don't bring that title back, please. Goddamn no.
Yes.
You know what? They can't crown the greatest hardcore champion without including the initials ECW. You know what?
Why are you going there?
Last week you said I can make any match I want. Edge. Mm-hmm. I want a hardcore triple threat match. And I got Edge, Foley, and the Innovator of Violence, ECW's Tommy Dreamer. And I laughed my fucking ass off. I fell on the floor, pissing and shitting. I couldn't handle myself. I was aghast that they said Tommy Dreamer is the best innovator of violence ever. The man looked supremely out of shape.
Who's the best innovator?
Who's the best innovator?
Got to be Sandman, guys. Come on, please. Hello.
No.
Come on.
Nah.
He bashed the freaking can on his head.
Yeah. I think the most innovative user of violence that anybody has seen on this roster currently is on SmackDown.
Is it? But... I was about to say, I know what you're going for, you fucker.
Hey,
it's true.
You can't talk about Boogeyman like that.
Yeah.
The main event runs the show.
Yeah, so fat, slobbish Tommy Dreamer's here, looking out of shape. They called him up from Philly. He didn't really know. Maybe his flight was late. He looks tired. got his kendo stick. They didn't even get music for him. They just got the ECW music. And they fucking kill each other immediately. Dreamer goes, oh, wait, am I
yes, doing the match? You're stepping on the segment. Read the outline.
You made the outline, you pervert.
I didn't make the outline. It was
no, weird. I did.
Whatever.
Listen, man, I was hot. I wanted to go into the match. That's my bad. Emerald, do the honors.
ECW. People are fucking wild about this. No. Like, I even saw they cut to the crowd. They got these giant ECW signs just plastered in blood. It's like they knew that this was coming for somehow. But yeah, this Buster from ECW with a kendo stick comes up. He's like buddy-buddy with Mick Foley. They get into the ring. Edge and Lita back out of the ring. They're scared. And so they're waiting. Like, come on, Edge, get into the ring. So Edge slowly creeps into the ring. And Mick Foley does a fucking backstab on this Buster from ECW with the barbed wire bat. And Edge's like, whoa, wait a minute.
What just happened?
And Foley looks at Edge. Edge is like, whoa, whoa, whoa. He puts the bat. He puts his bat down. And then Foley offers Edge his barbed wire bat. And then he just gets this shit-eating grin. Takes the bat and fucks Dreamer up in the head. Edge then offers the bat back up to Foley. Foley takes it. Hits Dreamer in the head again with the barbed wire bat. This man is on the ground, bleeding. They beat him up a couple... grab him by his legs, hoist him up, they place the barbed wire bat atop his nuts, and then Edge does a leg drop onto the bat into the man's nuts. He's on the ground, writhing in pain, as Batman changed back into Bruce Wayne. I'm sorry.
It's been temporary for this time. It's fine.
Yeah, you're right.
So, this man is just dying. Edge and Mick Foley are looking at each other like, yeah, we got him. WWE for life. Lita gets back into the ring. She and Edge lift this man up, hold him steady as Mick Foley. Oh, what's he got? He's got the sock! He's got the sock with the face on it, and it even, like, if you look closely, it says ECW on it. And he rams it into the guy's mouth, and they just fucking hold him there, sock in his mouth. Edge runs back, spears him, Mick Foley pins him. They both win, I guess.
Edge was also pinning him.
Yes. They shake hands, and they all walk away. In a matter of, what was it, 10 fucking minutes?
If that.
Are you kidding me? I was waiting for this one match so goddamn long, and it was that?
I thought it was awesome.
It wasn't long enough.
It was so good.
And they just beat up this one motherfucker. I have no idea who it is from out of nowhere. It was after the match. JR and the other guy are talking. This was definitely a setup. For what reason? I don't fucking know. I'm mad.
Context clues, pal.
Yeah, dude.
He brought out the ECW, man. He said he wanted to bring ECW in, and then he killed ECW.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
We're disrespecting ECW.
Yeah.
That's the goal.
Foley is in
BC Grub. BC Grub.
Who runs ECW?
Joel.
Get him on. Beat him up.
Stay tuned. Probably.
But, or... okay, yeah. It was a decent match. It was hardcore guys beating up this fucking schmutz from not their show. I guess it was funny, but I was there for Mick Foley versus Edge, not this setup stuff, but there was blood, so I will give this match a 6 out of 10.
Wow.
Would it make you feel better to know that the Penguin runs ECW?
Now, hold on. Are we talking Danny DeVito Penguin?
Yeah. I mean, basically.
Yeah. Okay. I'll bump that up to an 8 out of 10, then.
Alright, good. You'll see him eventually, or if you watch SmackDown this week, I'm sure he'll be there.
Listen, man. Ugh. That Socko mandible claw into his spear was rad as hell.
It was rad as hell.
So good. And I have the
sock collected blood.
I don't know how official ProWrestlingFandom.com is. It says Edge and Mick Foley defeated Tommy Dreamer, so I guess they both got the dub on that.
Yeah.
And it went 2 minutes and 18 seconds.
What?
Yeah, from bell to bell.
Jesus Christ, my concept of the passage of time must be fucking skewed.
Probably the promo first. Took a minute.
Yeah.
And there was a lot after.
But yeah, they took that man out quick. Yeah, invited him onto the show. This is beat him the fuck up.
Tommy Dreamer bled so much.
Yeah.
But they cut up his head so bad.
Mm-hmm. So Emerald doesn't know who Tommy Dreamer is. Dave, do you know who Tommy Dreamer is?
I don't know who Tommy Dreamer is. I mean, he's dead now, I guess, I've seen.
He's dead now.
What's your review of Tommy Dreamer? We've already heard Emerald.
So, I mean, he was a guy with a beard and face and hair, presumably from ECW, with the kendo stick or the Siamese smacker, whatever the fuck JR kept rumbling on about. And then he existed and died in 2 seconds. I have no care in my heart for Tommy Dreamer after what I just...
Can I explain?
No.
No.
Stupid.
Let Nico cook.
No, we will never see Tommy Dreamer or ECW again.
Yeah, that's why. Just let me throw it out there.
No.
Yeah, we'll never see it again. It's
never
fine.
Again.
Fine. Oh, God, this... album art Ty has posted in our Discord is haunting if you want to throw it up.
Look at him.
Oh my.
Oh wow.
We're having a bad dream.
Head on that guy.
Alright. Alright, Nico. What do you want to say about Bobby Dinger?
I was just gonna explain his main origin. Just to get it out there. So for those who don't know, the whole gimmick behind Tommy Dreamer was he was like the cool kid in school. And he had the girlfriend, Francine, and then Raven feuded with him all the time, and he lost every match.
It was rad.
Yeah, pretty much.
Pretty much, just to sum it up there.
He won the one time.
Yeah, he won once, and he was upset about it.
They found him in the same parking lot they found Jannetty in earlier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, where's he been?
There was... Well, I know he's not dead, but... By all means, he should be.
He probably should be, yeah.
Is this the highest concentration of CTE we've seen in a Raw match so far?
Possibly.
I'd say so.
The last thing before we move on to the next real gem of a match is my fiance... During the course of this match has a bit of a turn on Edge, where at first when Edge comes out, she makes the claim that Edge is hot, but the rated R superstar Adam Copeland is scary. And then later, at the end of the match, I don't know why she changed her mind on this so much, but she now takes back that Edge was hot, saying he's in the realm of hot, but just not quite there.
Whoa.
But he is still better than the rated R superstar Adam Copeland.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. All us wife guys out here have to deal with Edge. Because my wife was also like, Edge is a cutie. And I'm like, all right, that's fair enough. You know, I agree. I fair. You know what? I'll tap out to that. You're right.
He's a good looking dude.
That's right.
Yeah, I think Edge is hot. I don't know.
Yeah, dude.
Why
do you think he keeps ending up in these like sexual gimmicks?
I think she liked old Edge more than young Edge, though, when he was before he left the Fed.
Before he got black misted.
Yeah.
Get ready to censor, because this is gonna be a doozy.
All right, I'm gooning to the picture Ty sent me, and Nico's here to goon about the women. Let's go.
I gotta be right back.
Jerry also was just losing his mind for match. Good God. I don't know if you have this, Nico, but fuck, I have some things he said.
I didn't catch a lot. I mostly just caught, like, Jim Ross trying not to show his colors on commentary. Because he clearly agrees with fucking Jerry, but, like, he just tries to toss it under the brush and be like, oh, that is true indeed, Kang, yeah. And he's also cooning. Like, now that I know how he is from just following him on, like, fucking social media, like, dude, like, these guys are gooning together.
Like, you 1,000%. You do not want to see under that commentary table.
Wow. Let's get started with ground.
By God, King, don't check my IG Explorer. By God, King, please don't look.
Yeah. So, Goon Control to Major Com. It's the women's match. We got Mickie James, who comes out first because, you know, she's a champion and all. That's what they do, apparently. I mean, hey, I don't make the rules. That's WWE, right?
Uh-huh.
Followed by Maria with Trish Stratus, who's still got her arm in the sling, you know. Everybody's looking fine. They start off the match. It's your basic women's start. They hit some moves. There's hair pulling. It's kind of just there. There's the one point where Mickey tries to go for the DTT. She gets kind of slammed. It looks terrible. Terrible, but it then gets turned into a great DDT, which looks a lot fucking better. This is one of those, like, you know, then of course Mickey's got to go off on Trish. Again, this is not a match about the wrestling. Both of the matches I have are not about the wrestling in the slightest. But honestly, it's going okay. And then Trish gets involved and she jumps in the ring. She starts punching thing. Mickey gets the better of her. And it basically just becomes a mess after that, as all the refs and the security now have to pull everybody apart. Holy shit, I completely forgot. Didn't somebody run into?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, at the end of the match, somebody, I thought it was Ashley, but I don't think that's actually true.
It's not.
Who the fuck is that?
A blonde woman, a fan, allegedly, runs in and just starts beating the shit.
Yeah, do you want to know who it Mickey. Is?
I
know who it is too.
Okay.
And the security really manhandles, like, everybody involved here. Usually the security is, like, kind of light with everybody. They're just really throwing these women around.
Like, and let me tell you, they're screeching, because this is what fucking cemented my head. They're just screeching, like, this fan, and I think Mickey. It's like, I can't even tell who's saying what. They're just all, they sound the same screeching. It's like, guttural. It's honestly kind of annoying to watch. But this match existed. Mickey's pants, or shorts or trunks or whatever, were a little too tight and short. Because there were some risque shots in this match. And it existed. Maria might be the greatest wrestler of all time.
Yeah. My notes. My only note that has anything to do with this match is that Mickie James invented the Heat Seeker, so she needs royalties from MJF. Blood is all over this fucking ring. They did not change the canvas after Tommy Dreamer died in the last segment.
Which is fine. It's not as bad as when fucking Owen Hart died and they were still wrestling on the bloody mat.
Nothing will ever compare to that.
No, that was it.
You say that, but do you remember the ring after the worm at Mania?
You know that what?
That was probably a bigger in-ring tragedy, let's be honest, was all those worms.
Yeah, RIP worms. Yeah.
Okay.
Speaking of help, Jerry Lawler, this whole show, he's been a freak, and in this one, he just will not stop being horny.
No.
The whole time. The two I've written down are, I love the way Mickey bounces around that short little skirt. Just not even hiding it. And the worst one, while Maria is getting the dog shit beaten out of her and just rolling around on the ground in pain, Jerry Lawler, and this is a direct quote, says, "I love to see Maria writhing." Mm. Why?
Yeah, you're writhing all right.
Why?
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
I don't know.
Okay.
Like, I don't know. You might as well just said, Maria comes up to Zebra head, just like I come to her head. Just fucking sick, weird shit.
Does anybody know what Jim Ross was muttering about with the Bellamy brothers? Because all I could understand is I think the Bellamy brothers died about 20 years ago.
I have no idea.
Who the fuck is that? What is he talking about?
I can never understand JR.
He's just trying to cover his fellow gooningness, so only like King looks like the pervert.
Also,
so he's
at
just talking smack about anything.
And at the end of this match, I think the headsets just stop working because the commentators just stop for about 2 minutes while people are dying and Mickey is getting beaten up. And then JR mutters something about, well, we are live, and then gets into whatever he's promoting.
Yeah.
So, mess of a segment, headsets broken, real mess, and then everybody's favorite guy, Umaga, comes in to continue making the ring a mess these two men.
Wait, God damn it, no!
Yeah,
I just wanted to say one thing. I will say, Mickey James' championship run still getting buried hard.
Yeah, they hate her.
Yeah, they you could clearly tell. And again, she comes out first, she gets her shit kicked in, they drag her out, like, she gets nothing. You know, just like any jobber who steps in the ring with Umaga.
Oh my god.
Everybody listen to me.
Okay.
Every time the boy, Armando Alejandro Estrada, comes out to the ring, he always hits that to me so hard. It gets me very excited. Tonight's victims, he asks them, do they have a wife? Do they have a kids? It does not matter. As long as they have health insurance, because they're going to need it when they face the Samoan Bulldozer. You know, and then Umaga, of course, comes down to the ring. These men do not get official names ever until I think JR just kind of shouts out what their names are as they're being killed. They are Tommy Wilson and Kevin Martinson. I've tried to Google these guys. I really didn't get anything. They are truly, truly here to be killed by Umaga and nothing more.
Oh, I got some stuff on them.
Okay, sick. Umaga is regarded as remorseless and relentless. He's continually picking up Martinson and just slamming him into the ground, ties him up in the ropes, and then hits him with a super heavyweight headbutt, then climbs out of the ring and giant swings Wilson into the barriers, then hitting him with a running butt slam, breaking his neck against the wall. Comes back in the ring, does the same to Martinson, who's still against the turnbuckle, drags him into the center of the ring. Armando then holds up and breaks one of his cigars to symbolize it is time to kill him. Umaga then spikes Martinson in the neck, kills him immediately, and then just kind of gently pins him and then runs around screaming as the bell rings. Yet another just Omega squash match on some nobody jobbers for Umaga. When are they going to use him in any real capacity?
That one time.
Yeah, okay. But that was that one time, and this has been, a seven-week event?
He killed Ric Flair twice. Well, not only once officially.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It doesn't go anywhere. He just continues to fight random monsters of the week.
I think it's fun.
But I want to know what they're going to do with it.
Well, they already had him beat Flair to start it off, so they're probably just giving him something to build before they start the next feud, you know? So it's just a way to keep him on TV, keep him strong, and, You know, because he's doing squash matches now. You just need to give him something. And you don't want to beat Rob Conway, because I'll literally quit the pod.
Rob Conway was recovering from his injuries after getting just
cheated. Just
Benedict Arnolded last week. Cheated. Deprived. Rob Conway has grounds for a lawsuit, I think. This is bullshit.
I think that's very true.
Absolute fucking malarkey. So, Armando Alejandro Estrada, to direct, Umaga likes to yell Samoa a lot.
Yeah, Samoa!
It's not one particular move. He just yells Samoa, and then Umaga does something.
Yeah, I forgot to bring that up. This was the first time, I'd say it's been the most relevant, where Estrada is, like, handling and directing Umaga and using him as a weapon, as opposed to just letting Umaga run around and kill you. There's a lot of him just hitting the side of the ring and screaming Samoa and pointing at people, and then Umaga killing them.
Pretty good.
He also loves to snap his cigars in half whenever he gets a Samoan
spike. Snapping his penis for real.
Can't do that. Not allowed to do that. Listen, man. Tell me about Johnny Goodtime.
I'm going to tell you about Tommy Wilson first. Oh, there's a lot less on this guy, and Emerald's going to pop for something I'm about to say.
Oh, sick.
That I don't know anything about. It's not the first thing. So Tommy Wilson, I forget which of... One of these is like a tall guy, and one of them is a short guy. I don't remember who is who. But Tommy Wilson was apparently trained by Ken Shamrock.
Oh, hell yeah.
And he is a 7-time SCP champion. Which is a thing people on Tumblr talk about. I think it's a game. I don't know. He's some kind of weird monster, is my understanding. Anyway, Kevin Martinson is the guy who has actually done something. Kind of, maybe. Well, Tommy Wilson is a 7-time champ, but I don't know what this promotion is. Nobody important has ever been in SoCal promotion, whatever the hell it's called. But Kevin Martinson, a.k.a. Randy Rocket, a.k.a. Johnny Goodtime, appears to be currently the UWN Heritage Champion as of October 2023. It's the last match Cage Match has on record for this. So I guess he's still the champ. So good for him. He's still at it after all these years. Former champions... former UWN Heritage Champions are Peter Avalon, Scorpio Sky, Adam Pearce, TJP, and a man who truly got everything that he ever wanted, X-Pac, former UWN Heritage Champion.
That's my guy.
Throw up the X-Factor, Ty. Throw up that first 3 seconds. We're in it.
What'd you look at?
Yeah, X-Pac finally relevant. Again, on this show, I wish X-Pac was here. I actually didn't look up, what is X-Pac doing in 2006? What's the fucking MTV wrestling show? When does that
happen?
Wrestling
Society X happens in 07.
Yeah. Okay, so we're a year out from that, so he's probably knee-deep in a drug hole with China or something.
I think he might be in TNA.
Oh my. Check out whatever went extremely sideways crosses the line. In 75 years. Maybe you'll hear about 2006 TNA X-Pac, if that's true.
Okay, so Wrestling Society X airs in 07, but it was filmed in 06, February of 06. So you were cooking.
All right, it's relevant. Tune into You Don't Have to Society This soon.
We live.
For the Piranha Tank Death Match or whatever the hell.
Let's fucking go, dude.
X did. They got some guy named Tyler Black on there. He's a shitter. He'll never be good.
Oh,
I don't know. Yeah. I just saw him. I just saw him hating him.
Grimby Spiso?
I hope that guy dies and rolls in his grave.
Well, it's the Big Show. We got Big Show versus Kane again. Another Backlash rematch.
It's the Israeli Palestine of WWE.
Oh my.
Hey, Nico, who's who?
Big Show is... That's a great question.
I'm just gonna keep this going.
I'm gonna say Big Show is probably Palestine and Kane is...
Okay.
But honestly, they could roll reverse.
Well, Kane's here.
That's not making it.
Is, the Big Show is Ho Chi Minh. Let's go.
Yeah.
So Kane and Big Show are looking at each other. They're staring deep in each other's eyes. The crowd is going mild. And I don't know what clicked in their brain, but they decided, let's make a technical masterclass. So they start doing arm bars. They're reversing, going into another like arm lock. They're going off the ropes, shoulder block, drop toe hold. They're going crazy. They get the test of strength. The crowd's going like, what the hell is this? And the commentary's like, I didn't expect these guys to do a match like this. Another like hammer lock. Like, I don't know. What is Big Show cooking with these moves? They're doing all this shit. The crowd is mild as hell.
I was losing my mind.
It was like, what is happening? Show throws Kane from buckle to buckle. Drop toe hold by Kane. Drops him into the turnbuckle. And then the goofiest shit starts happening. The lights go off.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a bouncing Kane mask on the screen. And it starts yelling, May 19th, May 19th. And Kane goes, ah! Ah! And he starts freaking out. And Big Show's like, come on, man. Don't do that. And then Kane grabs a chair and gives the loudest fucking crack to the skull I've ever seen in my life. Why did he do him like that? Big Show is dazed and confused. And then Kane just starts whipping him with that chair and kills that man. I feel like we've seen this at least 10 times this month.
Yeah.
With the same cast of characters.
May 19th.
I hate this so much. I hate this May 19th bullshit.
Big Show wins in 5 minutes via DQ.
But why didn't he pin him?
It was over.
But last time, and I already yelled about this, last time, he fucking killed the man, left it, and when he got angrier, he decided to wrestle a wrestling match. This time, he wrestles a wrestling match, May 19th happens, and now he's a killer?
How could he do this?
This is stupid.
Yeah, I don't know what they're currently cooking with this.
And this is clearly... The only reason they did such a good technical match is because they're trying to sell the story of, like, oh, see, like, when Kane's normal, they're fine. He's a professional wrestler or a superstar or whatever. And then May 19th happens, and now he's a cheater.
I also forgot, they did shake hands at the beginning. I don't know why. Yeah. Big Show should be very furious at this man for, like, poking his eye out and beating the snot out of him constantly.
Kane rejected the handshake.
I mean, yeah, this man has mental health problems, okay? I mean, I guess he's inconsistent.
Which one?
Kane. I guess that's part of the story. I don't know. This thing sucks. I hate this.
Yeah, it was really bad.
It's bad. It's super bad. It's like the worst fucking thing on earth.
This show did not cook.
No, the show was medium rare. No, it was just rare.
I got to pass this over to the main event guy, because what were they cooking in this match? We're not even in the main event.
It's my time to ruin a transition.
No,
it's my time.
No, what was up with this match? I'm telling you about Big Show and Kane. Why did you like it? There's no transition here.
Because Big Show did a fucking drop toe hold and did a sassy little dance. They were doing arm bars and drop toe holds and shit. That was funny. That was cool. For like the 3 minutes it took. I'm not saying Kane's PNG screensaver head bouncing around on the Titan and saying May 19th was good. I'm saying the part where they did a real wrestling match for like 2.5 minutes was cool.
Because
I did not expect it.
Do you think they gave a 20-minute match in the Tokyo Dome?
I hope so. If they're not cowards, they're going to do that.
Maybe we'll see it on our Wrestle Kingdom review at some point in the future.
Wrestle Kingdom, what, 2007?
No,
06, I guess.
I think it's like the Tudo Chapter 1 show or
okay.
whatever.
Okay. All right, we're going back in time to January 06 to review Wrestle Kingdom.
That's right, baby.
Tenzan versus Tanahashi or something. I don't
yes.
know. Also, Jim Ross during this match says, "Well, cut off my legs and call me Shorty. I didn't expect a scientific match tonight." Which was pretty good.
A lot of May 19th signs in the crowd.
There's a train coming, and it's got May 19th written all over it.
Yeah, you're gonna get like a rocket power, like, and it's gonna have an intro. It's gonna say Barnes and Hell.
Woogity, woogity, woogity.
What? Yeah, you ever see the intro card for Rocket Power, and it goes like,
yes, I've seen the Rocket Power intro.
You know, it's Martin's in Hell.
It's the Rocket Power intro, and there's the screen that says Martin's in Hell at the end of it.
You'll see.
Yeah, it's gonna have like Raimundo and like Tito at the bottom smiling at the camera also.
It's analog horror. Podcast
Ty is writing a lot of checks that Editor Ty is gonna have to cash in like 7 months, dude. I don't know.
You can't write a check that your butt can't cash. That's Rocket Power 101, folks. Come on.
Who on this show is Squid?
Oh, that's Emerald for sure.
That's easily Emerald. Are you kidding me?
I meant on the wrestling program, but also, yes.
Emerald.
Emerald.
Woogity, woogity, woogity.
Yeah, Benny.
Okay. What the fuck is this show? What are we doing? It's been an hour. And
this show was immensely mid. We're trying our best.
Hey, this is kind of like, as we talk about it, I realize this is a really mid show, but we're actually doing decent time. Because we've been going 130 the last couple weeks.
Yeah. Immensely Mid really should have been the name of this this just podcast, this whole thing.
This
like
the
show.
Just the name of the episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, the show, yeah. The mic quality, us as people.
I want everyone to know that, so I rewatched Raw before we started recording. From the start of Raw to the main event, I ate about 60 pizza rolls and have become basically in a coma for the last hour, aside from me powering through doing my segments. I now have all of the pizza roll energy. So, Martin, better be careful.
All right, what's the brand of pizza roll you ate? Let's do some math real quick.
Totino's. I'm not a fucking idiot. All right, I'm not a Fink.
Only brand.
You're not a Fink, did you just read fucking Catcher in the Rye looking at JD Salinger looking son of a bitch? What the fuck, dude?
How dare this guy think I'm gonna have not Totino's pizza rolls.
I apologize. I'm a little mellow today.
Alright. Okay, so you've eaten what? You think 60 pizza rolls?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's it's actually coming in lower than I expected. That's only 10 servings of pizza rolls, so that's only 3.8 grams of salt, which is only 160% of your daily intake.
That's not bad.
That is nowhere near as much as Emerald ate that one time he ate most of a family-sized can of ravioli and had to go lay down.
All right. Patreon subscribers, if we get 1 million subscribers, I will eat an entire family-sized can of Chef Boyardee ravioli.
Yeah!
Uncooked.
Someone find the picture of Emerald where he looked like Prometheus eating the fire.
I feel like that's
eating the fire?
Let me put the guy behind you.
Explain to me how Prometheus eats fire. I'm just wondering. I know what you're talking about.
Well, that's how he stole it. That's how he gave it to the people. He ate a bunch of it and then crawled down Mount Olympus, went bleh, and then gave it to people. Everyone knows this is how it worked.
Oh my. Guys, Editor Ty's knocking on the door. He says, stop it. He says, stop.
Get him out of here.
He said, stop. Stop.
This is a mythology podcast now.
I already told the police to go away.
Please end it.
Speaking of...
Nobody wants to talk this main event.
Oh, I would love to talk about this main event. We are as present and coherent in our current state as Lemmy is sitting ringside. Definitely look like he absolutely knows where he is or what's going on.
Motorhead.
He's shown on camera ringside here for the Spirit Squad versus John Cena and Shawn Michaels. Lemmy, he loves these Spirit Squad little guys. He's all about it. They embody the spirit of Motorhead, for sure, in that they suck. So, we start this off with a plug for the next Saturday night's main event. This one's in Dallas in July. Will we have a Saturday night's main event that is any good? Probably not. Are we all going to be on that show? Absolutely. Probably. Will it be as much of a struggle to talk about this show as it is to talk about this one? Almost definitely. Jerry Lawler pitches that Lemmy should join the Spirit Squad. I don't know why. There's no context for it other than Lemmy's here and it is not addressed again. Jim Ross just lets that bit die. And now the Spirit Squad start doing their chants that they... Do we think they're bad at this on purpose, or are they just legitimately bad? Because they are never in rhythm.
No. It's gotta be on purpose.
It was bad.
So off-key and out of rhythm, they inform us Cena and Shawn have to take us on, live on Monday Night Raw, from the pond. Took me a second to figure out why they're calling it that. It's because this is where the Anaheim Mighty Ducks play. They call it the pond, I guess. Oh. Shout out to Ducks and hockey. Wait. Anyway, they say, we're going to kick their butts, and all you fans are going to cheer for Kenny, Johnny, Mitch, Nikki, Mikey, and your tag champs are here. Jerry Lawler says they're receiving a standing boo. Yeah. I just heard dead air. I don't think anybody cared. We sure don't. Shawn Michaels comes out. The crowd gets excited about this, and all the Spirit Squad stand there like, you cannot get in the ring, Shawn Michaels. There are five of us. And Shawn, with one of his eyes, well, with both of his eyes, he can track everybody in the whole arena. So he goes, you know, I probably can't. I'm going to wait for Jahan. So Jahan's scene comes out to a mixed reaction. And Peacock has stolen our abilities to screen grab things, but just trust me on this. Somebody has a line art JoJo-looking ass John Cena poster that they've drawn. It's pretty cool. He's the least gay thing about JoJo, and that's saying something. Damn. So John Cena comes out. Shawn Michaels and John Cena chase him off. And Jim Ross starts for an extended period of time talking about Texas Tech University, which is where they'll be next week. He plugs this four times. He doesn't have to, but he just keeps talking about Texas Tech. This can't be a football thing. He's an Oklahoma fan. I know they're in the Big 12, but Texas Tech and Oklahoma don't give a shit about each other. Texas Tech sucks at football, unless that one time they had Michael Crabtree. Shout out to, like,
oh my,
they might, like, 2007. Check out our review of the 2007 or whatever college football season.
Let's
in do 900
it.
Years.
Yeah.
Just kill me. Just kill
We're going to watch every single college football game from 2007 and review it.
You don't want to do that.
All of them.
You don't want to do
I know.
That.
Guys, except for one of them.
I got a question. Is Shawn Michaels Sting Chameleon?
Yes.
Thank you.
But that only means that John Cena's Storm Eagle. That's right.
Let's go. Let's fucking go, dude.
Some revelations here tonight.
I don't know what these losers are talking about.
He's gonna hit with a boomerang cutter. It's gonna be crazy.
Yeah, Nico's boomerang quanger, dude.
That sounds bad.
Yo!
Is that bad?
Yes.
You fucker.
He's boomer quanger. Don't talk shit to him.
So Kenny and Shawn start this match off, and Kenny's like, ooh, Shawn, you stole my win from me last week. How dare you? He wins a tie-up, yells again, like, how dare you? They slap each other in the face for a while, fight for some amount of time. John Cena tags in to booze. Nikki tags into his standard response, which is nothing. Kids start chanting Cena's name. The old people start booing. We're doing this bit now. Jim Ross says Cena is the most controversial champion in WWE for a variety of reasons. What does Jim Ross know? What is he talking about? What are the other reasons that John Cena is controversial?
Because he gets Cena suck chance? I don't know.
Anyway, we get some really weird hold attempts. It looks like they're dancing for a minute. And then Nikki hits an arm drag takedown, crucifix pin. John Cena fires up with the shoulder blocks. Spirit Squad now all rush John Cena, but it's like the Kung Fu movie where only one of them do it at the time, and they are all dispatched summarily. Kenny is standing on the ropes, just yelling at the Spirit Squad and the crowd, and then Cena and Shawn Michaels look at each other like, hey, he's an idiot. Throw him back in, beat him up. Then, in maybe the only cool thing that happens in this match, they lob Kenny over the top rope onto all the Spirit Squad. That looked cool. We go to commercial. Back from the commercial, Cena has just gotten a hot tag. He runs wild, hits his 2K comeback, hoists Johnny up for the FU. Then the Spirit Squad again do the Kung Fu movie in, and Cena has to drop Johnny to fend them off. But off of the distraction, Johnny hits the Trouble in Paradise for two, and now we get a very extended sequence where, other than one time, where they set up a trampoline on the outside and a very bad flying clothesline is hit on John Cena. They just all take turns tagging in, beating him up, getting a two count, doing the same thing, cheating repeatedly, because this ref just will not stop going over and yelling at Shawn Michaels. This is probably 7 minutes of this match is just John Cena getting beat up, pin attempt, two, kick out, repeat. Repeat. I could talk about this for a while. This was fun match for a while, but it started taking way too long. Blah, 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 blah. I'm just going through my notes. We've already been going 17 hours. I don't need to say all this. Eventually, Shawn Michaels gets the hot tag. To their credit, the crowd is still awake and loses their mind for Shawn Michaels. He cleans house. The camera misses the kip up because John Cena is being thrown into the steps. And there's the whole bunch of chaos happening right now. Everybody's fighting everybody. It's an AEW match. And then off of the ref being distracted by some element of the everything that's happening in and around the ring, Kenny gets one of the tag belts, hits Shawn Michaels in the head with it as the ref has his back turned, pins Shawn Michaels, 1-2-3. The Spirit Squad have defeated Shawn Michaels and John Cena. Kenny then kicks the shit out of the ref and steals his belt to beat up Shawn. Jim Ross says that Shawn is being whipped like a government mule. I know that Pop Dave, he loves that shit. Triple H comes out looking pissed and beefy, I've written, as John Cena throws out everybody else. So it's just Shawn, the ref, and Cena in here. And Triple H is coming out, gets in the ring, hits John Cena with the pedigree because he's cool and epic and deserves a title shot after just being a petulant bitch baby shitter this whole time. I guess we're just going to get another one of these goddamn matches because Triple H, even though he constantly loses, has to be like, I'm good and cool. I'm the guy, even though I lose all the time. This Triple H character is just CM Phil if CM Phil had any amount of talent, and that's stretching it. So, yeah, that's your show. Okay, main event.
What happened to Kenny? What happened to Kenny?
What a mid-show.
Why is Kenny, like...
He pinched Shawn.
No, but, like, Kenny's cool. That's what I learned from this. I think Kenny's actually a good wrestler.
He's very John Cena didn't like him.
Yeah, wasn't he... To Kenny. Wasn't he the one who was supposed to get, like, the main push from the Spirit Squad?
Yes. Yes, if you believe Kenny and Dirt Sheets... Basically, Kenny was dating Mickie James, and then John Cena decided actually he wanted to fuck Mickie James, and then said Kenny sucks and got him out of the company.
Yeah, for the listeners at home, this may be future technology information, but Kenny doesn't, in fact, become the turbo hero of the world like you would think he would.
What do you mean?
No, that's Nikki.
Who?
Nikki! I can't do it. My mouth hurts.
You know, the show was mid. We were mid. We did a lot today. We're all exhausted.
All right, but for real, that ref fucking sucked for that last match. I hate him. I hope he got fired.
Who was it?
Yoda? Eventually, yeah. He did.
Way later.
Why did he get fired?
I think he just, I don't know. I don't know if he actually got fired. He just
It was because of this match. It was
okay. Yeah, nah. 17 years later, Vince remembered.
Was he the one who was the QAnon one?
No.
No. No, that's...
Yeah, no, that was Nico. That.
No, it wasn't. Don't you
Oh, my.
Oh, he just retired, I think.
Yeah, Drake Younger is QAnon ref. Earl Hebner is the one that was selling bootleg merch with his brother outside of the arenas. Out of his car.
Yeah, that's what's all about. Oh, he got released and then he retired at Ric Flair's last match.
Yeah?
Just, why would they have him do that?
Listener, write in and let me know if this episode is over yet or not. Ty's been trying to end it for a while. But we might still be going.
You guys can keep it going. That's up to you.
Launch Octopus.
It's the never-ending bit. And you know what?
You've been raw downed.
No, we haven't. Not yet.
I got cage matchup.
We will not end this show. We won't let Ty stop recording.
You know what?
You have to sit here and suffer.
Buster.
Hang on. Let me get up the DDoS.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. No. Hold up. Oh. Actually, we got something crazy. Dave Meltzer gave that main event a 3.25 star.
Three and a quarter star.
Why do people get mad about its reviews again?
Yeah.
Meltman reviewed it. Jesus Christ. Meltman reviewed main events.
Meltman reviewed the main event. Got the 3 quarter.
I mean, Will Ospreay is kind of right. This
yo,
this
man, y'all reviewed the main event.
Come on in, yo.
My God.
All right. Cajun Dave Meltzer, new character.
Hello, Dave.
Baby Flair died.
Welcome to the brain. Welcome to the after show, guys.
This is for the patrons only. You just get to hear us melting.
Dave Meltzer, more like Meltman, am I right?
This show sucks. And I'm getting spoiled on who's coming in and who's leaving, and I'm dreading my life now. I made some bad decisions.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, like, we're losing, like, Lita this fucking year, man.
Yeah, but come on, we got Beth Phoenix, dude.
Who gives a... is that who ran in? Okay. I'll take that as a yes.
I think that's how we end it. Is that who came in?
What a fucking episode. Jesus Christ.
That was a good.
I'm never ending it. We're still on.
Oh, that was a good. Oh, fuck yeah, dude. Are we still podcasting? All right, hold on.
All right, well, let's get in the Goat Squad.
All right, so listen. This is what you need to understand, right? Shawn Michaels, he is Stink Chameleon because his eyes are crazy. And he was born when Hephaestus came down and smelted the ultimate being, Shawn Michaels.
What? Humans are crazy.
Goodness gracious.
Is that something that happened in 2008?
That's Martin. He knows.
Yeah.
I like how I'm Prometheus who ate the fire.
Well, duh.
Yeah, I've been trying to find that. I had it favorited at one point. I feel like it's still on my phone.
This show does fucking suck. My God.
Please excuse my dark ambient swag.
Where's that fucking meme you said you had about...
I already did it.
Oh, I thought it was a post.
I think we all got raw downed.